Hi friends, my name is Laura and welcome to Book Bubbler. Okay, I've got my June TBR video for you today. It's a bit chaotic and I've spent most of this morning and probably an hour and a half last night trying to get things straightened up and settled and figure out overlaps, if there are any, for the readathons I'm doing. And I've just sort of, I hit my limit. I'm just gonna start. And it's going to be a little crazy probably, but a very fast preview. So here are the readathons I'm doing this month. It's a lot. And most of them are happening in the middle of the month. So it's going to be extra crazy from, let's see, the most of them are the 9th through the 20th. Those are like the middle 2 weeks there is the most insane. But yeah, I had to figure this out this morning. I was like, okay, no wonder I'm confused. All right. So before I get into any specific readathons, I'll just talk about the books that I want to read that are shockingly not part of some massive project. So last week or week before, recently, I had a really, really nice FaceTime chat with one of my subscribers and her daughter and Danny at Spinelli Speaks. Going forward, I will, of course, link everyone I talk about below. And if I forget someone, please tell me. It's not my intention to forget anyone, but sometimes I just want to get it posted after a while. Anyway, so we had a really, really nice FaceTime conversation. And her daughter is, I believe, 8 or 9. And she was talking about the books she was reading, and they sounded so good, I wanted to read them all myself. So I got them from the library. So first up, I have Warriors Into the Wild by Erin Hunter. This is the start of a very long series. I believe there are like 5 or 6 chunks of books. Like there's 6 book series in an overarching series, kind of like Robin Hobb, you know. Don't know what they're about. I'm assuming cats, but that's all I know. Number 2 is White Fox by Chen, Jiatong. From what I remember about this, this is the first book translated from Chinese into middle grade that's being published. The second book in the series is being translated right now. So it's supposed to be very good, and she said it really ends really well, and she really wants a second one like yesterday. So this should be really good extra then. The third book, and I know this is popular with a lot of older grade school and middle school kids. This is Wings of Fire, The Dragonet Prophecy by 2ET Sutherland. I'm familiar more with the graphic novels or comics. I'm not sure what the definition is for those, but I have seen those more than I've seen the books. I didn't know they were books, so happy to see this. And the last recommendation I got from her is The Girl Who Drank the Moon by Kelly Barnhill. This has been around off and on for quite a while, and I've heard really good things about this one, so looking forward to that. So I've got those 4 I would just like to read this month, just to read them and enjoy them. Then 4 kind of one-offs or buddy reads. Of course, I have my next installment in the Pink Carnation series with Danny at Spinelli Speaks. Again, this is The Mischief of the Mistletoe by Lauren Willig. This episode, this book takes place back in England. The previous book was in India. This one is back in England again, and it's set around Christmas time. So I've got, I'm just throwing them. I had neat piles. Who am I kidding? Then 4... Bert's 90s Book Club, Bert at Pest Storytime. This month it's Tipping the Velvet, there we go, by Sarah Waters. I've never read her stuff before despite owning, I think, 5 or 6 titles, so I'm very happy to have the excuse to read this one for the 90s Book Club. Okay, and for Pride Month, I'm not going to try and squeeze anything extra in necessarily. I mean, I will if I've got openings, but judging on my calendar, I don't think I'll have a lot of openings aside from books I'm already reading. So for Pride, this is a new book. If you saw me haul something recently, you saw this, but I just want to read this so badly. Winter's Orbit by Everina Maxwell. This is a queer romance space opera. So excited to read it. It should be so good. Okay. This has got a smaller stack and it's right in front of me, so let's do that. For CaribAthon, I am really excited to do CaribAthon this year. Last year, I just missed it. I knew it was coming up and I just did not put it in my plans. I was not making TBRs as religiously last year as I have been this year. So two of these you will see that are, again, you will have seen recently. And the other one, Anyway, so these are my possibilities. So These Ghosts Are Family by Maisie Card. This one, Jamaica is the Caribbean island there. Oh, I should say, CaribAthon is hosted by the two fabulous ladies. And oh my gosh, please go check them out and subscribe to them if you have not. They are so wonderful. Love them both. Love them. Karen of Run Right Reads and Pita at Comfy Cozy Up. Pita has great vlogs. Okay, then number two possibility is The Reef by Nora Roberts. This doesn't specify in the flap, at least, where it is, but they are treasure hunting and snorkeling. Just generic Caribbean. That's all it says, is just the depths of the Caribbean. So your guess is as good as mine, but it's set there, so so it counts, right? And then this one, I rearranged my shelves yesterday a little bit, I know, and I didn't realize this was, let me look at this, Basil's Dream by Christina Hale. I would never have put this in the Caribbean, but apparently it is. So this is published by Livingston Press, the University of West Virginia. I'm assuming not many people have heard of this. So I'll read the little blurb in the back. It's just a short paragraph. A love affair exposes violence and deceit at the heart of not just two unhappy families, but an island nation's history. In Basil's Dream, soul-searing truths awaken in the streets of Bermuda, shattering lives and bringing a stumbling government to its knees. Basil's Dream melds the personal to the political to offer a redemptive vision, the world as a place where destruction and moral ambiguity enlarge hope rather than annihilate it. Now, Bermuda, I don't think, is technically part of the Caribbean, even though it's right next to what's considered the Caribbean. I don't know why there's a separation there or why there isn't, so I thought I would mention this in case it does qualify, or if it doesn't, and if someone wants to like read this book, go check it out. Also, I really like University of West Virginia. I'm so sorry, I said West Virginia. It's West Alabama Press, Livingston Press. I've purchased several things from them before and liked them all. So another little press to check out. So, okay, that's CaribAthon. Let me check my notes. It doesn't help. I have notes all over the place either. No one is surprised that things are chaotic in my house, are they? They shouldn't be. Okay, let's just do this one next. So, next up is Pastoral June. This is a brand new readathon, and I am really excited because I can just roll things right in from Springathon that I didn't finish and all the book Naturalist books I haven't finished so far this year. Anyways, Pastoral June is hosted by Angie at Literary Labor. She's so wonderful. And Summer over at Cozy Living with Quaker Cats. So we have four prompts. The first prompt is a pastoral image on the cover. I am picking my current purse book, The Lilac Bus by Maeve Binchy. That seems pretty pastoral to me, don't you think? And I've already started this, so, you know, whatever. Number two is a rural setting. So I am picking Country Matters. I did not get to this for Springathon. This is by Claire Layton, and Claire moved out into the countryside from London in the 1930s, I believe. 39. Nope. I don't know when. Early 1920s. Early 20th century. There we go. What are words? And she's also an engraver. So you get engravings of hers as well, of living in the country. Number three is a children's book set in the country. This was so exciting for me. I had such a good time going through my shelves and finding something, and I found one that I thought I had read and I have not. It's a Brambley Hedge book. I love the Brambley Hedge series, you guys. This is by Jill Barklem. All of them are by Jill Barklem. So Jill Barklem and, oh my gosh, Jenny. Oh my God, I can't remember her last name. The two of them, they have very similar vibes, country stuff. It's all anthropomorphic animals. They're very small, sweet watercolor illustrated books. I just adore them. Yeah, they're just fabulous. Peter Campbell and Snuff and Mr. Squint are the two books I'm thinking of from my childhood. But anyways, this one, Poppy's Babies by Jill Barklem. I don't know where this is in the Brambley Hedge universe. I don't think it matters, but I just cannot wait to read this. And just look at the cover. I mean, just so sweet. And then the last prompt for Pastoral June is to join in the group read, which is Lark Rise to Candleford by Flora Thompson. I've wanted to read this for years, and even especially since the first season of the TV show came out. It was such a nice adaptation. I mean, not having read the book, I don't know, but it was so enjoyable to watch, and I just really liked it. So I'm really glad to have an excuse to try and bump this up to the top of my list. So those four are for Pastoral June. All right, next up is the Categorically Romance series. This is hosted by Bree. Bree Hill. I don't know what Bree's Instagram address is, and I apologize, Bree. She used to be on BookTube. I really miss her channel. So it's hosted by Bree and hosted by the wonderful Sarah at Bookish Knitter. It's all to get people to read category romance. Now, this is the one readathon where I had to use the public library. Everything else I already owned, and everything coming up I already own. But the category romance that I have in my house that I've already purchased, nothing fit the prompts, which, oh darn. So I've got some stuff here. And I thought the library was open today. I'm filming this on Saturday the 29th. It is not open for a long holiday weekend. So I'm missing some books here. So I only have three, but there are five prompts total. So again, this is all category romance. This one runs from June 5th to the 20th. So the prompts are, number one, a 2021 release. I already had this one checked out, so this works out well. It's One Hot New York Night by Melanie Milburn. This is part of the Presents series, and this was published in April of this year. The second one is Own Voices, and again, I already had this one checked out from the library. So this is A New Foundation by Rochelle Ehlers. This is part of the Special Edition series, and this was published also in April of this year. And I have read Rochelle Ehlers before and really enjoyed her. The name of which escapes me. I don't remember the title of the book, but I know I really liked it. So this should be really good too. Number three is published before 2020. And my library didn't have any. I checked at Half Price when I was there. I couldn't find anything that was from the 90s or 80s or anything earlier. The thrift store I was at recently only had like early 2000s. So I ordered a few titles off of thrift books. I have no idea what they are anymore. That was like, you know, a whole 2 days ago. So they'll be coming sometime soon, and I will be reading one of those. Not to be, you know, coy, but I really don't know what the heck I ordered. Okay, number four, an imprint that is no longer published. And Harlequin is, I would say, notorious for dropping lines after a while, or, you know, whatever. One line I really liked was the Kimani line, which was typically Black or African-American stories. I did really like that. There were some nice series in there, and that got dropped. I mean, who knows? So I picked up Duets. These are essentially rom-coms, and you get two books for the price of one. So this duet book is Between the Covers by Kathy Linz and The Matchmaker's Mistake by Jane Sullivan. Kind of hard to read that early 2000s font, isn't it? So I've got some duets. And then the last prompt is a summer cover. And that one is at the library waiting for me. And I don't remember anything other than it is a Blaze book. So there you go. That's Categorically Romance. Okay. And now for the big readathon. This one happens every June. This is the fifth one. This is my second time participating. And oh my gosh, I love this one so much. It's the Golden Girls Readathon. Yay! This runs June 4th through the 18th. It's hosted by the fabulous, the fantastic Rachel Fryman. Please go check her out. She does such a good job with this. This is, yeah, anyways. Okay, so there are two challenges in each readathon. And if you've participated previously and won a golden ticket by answering trivia or completing something, if you've won a golden ticket, it earns you one free read. So you can just read whatever you want and it would count for that. And I have a golden ticket because I won the trivia round for the Cozy Mystery trivia that happened in the fall. So Common challenges. There are 5 prompts for the common challenges for this Golden Girls Readathon. Let me get my books over here. 2 different stacks. Okay, so the first common prompt is to read a 50 plus year old character. And my brain went right to the first of the Antipoldi mysteries. This is Antipoldi and the Sicilian Lions by Mario Giordano. I also have this one on, what is that called? Audio. So I might listen to this instead of reading it, but we'll see. This should be really good. I mean, who wouldn't want to read a series with a 60-year-old lady retiring to Sicily and getting involved in some shenanigans in town? Sounds good to me. The number 2 common challenge is to read a book published or set in the 1980s or 1990s, just like The Golden Girls was when it was airing. So I have this book set in the 1980s. It's The Music Shop by Rachel Joyce, set around a record store. And I started reading this one and it was really good. So I was very happy to have to pick it back up again. Number 3, a book has girl or girls in the title. And there are so many books out there I know that have girl or girls in the title. But again, I was just trying to only use the stuff that I have. And this was a book, this one here was a book that I did not get to in May for my birthday month. So now I really have to read it. It's The Fairy Tale Girl by Susan Branch. This is the first of her, so far, 2 memoirs that I'm aware of. And it's all handwritten and hand illustrated and has photographs and stuff by Susan Branch. I really just like her vibe and appreciate everything about her. So really glad to have this. Also, this weighs a ton, so it's good for a workout. Number 4, features a found family. Again, that's a lot of places, but I'm going to go with this one. You'll have seen this in my March TBR. I didn't finish it. It's The School for Good and Evil, book number 2, A World Without Princes. This is by Soman Chainani. The found family here is all of the groups of girls and boys at the School for Good and Evil. This is the second school year. It's starting up again, and there are some major ramifications from the end of the first book that apparently the 2 main characters, or the 2 main girls, did not see coming. I don't know how they couldn't have, but yeah. So this is about them rectifying the school and everything, but the found family is really each other, of course. And the 5th prompt is a book written by a woman, which will just be practically anything I read this month, so who knows what that will be. Okay, so then after those common challenges, you pick the girl that you, your favorite girl, or the girl that you want to read her prompts for or whatever. And this year I'm picking Sophia as my golden girl. And if you pick Sophia because she came in last year in the readathon, in the race, you get to start on the 1st of the month instead of the 4th of the month. So I figure that's good. I could certainly use an extra couple of days. So Sophia's prompts are to read a book less than 200 pages because Sophia is short. And I am picking the classic Zazie and the Metro by Raymond Queneau. My French is, how do you say, terrible. But I'm picking this little slim guy set in Paris. It is right around 150 pages. Prompt number 2 for Sophia is contains a recipe. You might have seen this in my May TBR. This is The Coincidence of Coconut Cake by Amy E. Reichert. Amy is a local author to me. She lives in the Milwaukee area as well. And there is a recipe for the aforementioned coconut cake at the back of this. Okay, prompt number 3 for Sophia is historical fiction. And I'm going to double up on that and read Tipping the Velvet by Sarah Waters for that as well. Number 4, the author's name starts with a G for Estelle Getty. And I am ashamed to say I purchased this. I think I even pre-ordered it. So this is a first edition. I've had it since it came out, and I haven't even touched it since I shelved it. And everyone I know loves it. It's Yaa Jessie's Homegoing. Ugh, it's time. It's time. And the 5th and final prompt for Sophia is to read a book by or featuring an immigrant. And I had easy fits for everything at this point, and I still have my free read. So my golden ticket. So I'm going to use my golden ticket for the book Buyer Featuring an Immigrant, just because my brain was so done with thinking. By the time I got to this morning, I was like, whatever. So I will just slot in one of the books I have already read and count that for Sophia. So I think that is everything on my plate in June. It could certainly be much busier. I didn't talk about Book Naturalists. The Book Naturalist pick this month, that's also at the library waiting for me right now. It's by Dara, is it McAnulty or McAnulty? I forget which, I apologize. Diary of a Young Naturalist. That's waiting there for me at the library. And what else? The Anahata Bookclub run by Sean at Past Story Time. I don't remember the title, I apologize. But I couldn't get a hold of the book and I was trying to save money, so I didn't order. But please go check out the Anahata Book Club. They have their own Instagram, and then of course it's also on the Pastory Time channel as well. But that looked really interesting this month. Oh my gosh, Big Carnation CaribAthon, Pride Month, so-called 90s. Okay, I think I have everything. I'm sure I forgot something, but we're just gonna call it. This has been long enough. So if you are in the States, I hope you guys all enjoyed your Memorial Day weekend. I'm going to go plant the flowers I just purchased. Again, today is Saturday for me. And I hope everyone else had a wonderful weekend as well. You're all doing well and reading something fabulous. If you are joining in any of these readathons too, please let me know. You should consider joining all of them because they're all run by wonderful, fabulous people. And who doesn't like making a good book list, right? All right, I will talk to you guys very soon. Bye.